Good evening, everybody. Buonasera. I'm very happy to meet you all, to have you welcome you all at the Tatti in such great numbers, which is a compliment to our wonderful performer today and this wonderful program that he has proposed. My introduction will be very short, just to say that I'm very grateful to Pedro Memmelsdorf, who is our impresario extraordinaire, who has been working with Tatti since I'm director here, so this is my fifth year here, so this has been a while, as the person that we entrusted to identify and bring to us young talent, established talent, famous performers, and create a program of music in our concerts. I will only introduce very briefly Pedro, because most of you know him already. He's a musician, a music director, and a medievalist musicologist who was once a fellow at Villa Tatti, and he's coming back to us in the spring when he will be a visiting professor in musicology. Currently, he's based at the University of Tours as an associate researcher at the Centre d'études supérieures de la Renaissance. He also maintains ongoing affiliations with institutions including Utrecht University, Escola Superior de Música Catalunya in Barcelona, the International Musicology Society, the Cini Foundation, and he has served as director of the Scuola Cantorum in Basel. As a musician, he has been a member of Jordi Savall's Hesperion 2021 since 1981, and of a duo with Andreas Thayer since 1984. I will stop here because this could go on for a while. I'm extraordinarily pleased that Pedro introduced Hopkinson Smith, our performer today, a world-renowned lutenist, to us, and that he accepted to join us. I just want to identify one little thing. Pedro will continue with the introduction. He's a graduate of Harvard University. So he is coming from the Casa Madre, and I'm very proud to say that he is among us as a Harvard alumnus. But that's not the most important one of his achievements. And for those, I will let Pedro introduce him.
Buonasera a tutti, very welcome, and thank you, Lina, for your presentation. Way too generous. Well, most of you might know Hopkinson Smith. He's perhaps the most impressive virtuoso living lutenist we know. And he has performed with almost every important ensemble in the beginnings of the early music wave and years. When I was very small, and he was one of my teachers. And then he developed a stunning solo career playing lute, theorem, and all the family of string instruments all over the world. So it's a pleasure and an honor to have Poppy here tonight. So I'm very pleased. Non introduco il lutista che sicuramente conoscete, il più celebre, virtuoso lutista vivente del momento, membro di tutti i grandi ensemble della rinascita della musica antica degli anni 70, 80, 90 e poi così protagonista di una carriera solistica strabiliante e unica. La musica che sentiremo oggi è un po' un contrasto, sono prima dei compositori inglesi fondamentalmente, dopo un breve excursus di preludi di Francesco da Milano della metà del Cinquecento, c'è un gruppo di composizioni inglesi, fondamentalmente di Anthony Hawthorne e John Dowland, famosissimi entrambi, ma molto diversi. Ecco, Hawthorne, compositore molto giovane di influenza, direbbe oggi, con questo campo, è un compositore di molta musica per lutto e di consorts, musica per gruppi, di strumentisti o di cantanti anche in realtà in situazioni domestiche, molto amato come compositore per gli amatori della fine del Cinquecento, fino al Seicento. Dowland invece era famosissimo, forse uno dei più famosi compositori inglesi del fine del 500 e primo 600 inglese, famoso in tutta Europa. A Parigi, per un lungo tempo, convertito al cattolicesimo, quindi con dei problemi a regolare l'Inghilterra e a trovare una posizione a corte, ebbe tutta una serie di esperienze, prima italiane, lunghissime in tante città italiane, e poi in Danimarca. Ecco, questi due compositori vengono poi confrontati a contrasto con un liutista compositore nato invece in Italia, probabilmente a Venezia, vissuto a Roma, molto molto alto locato, sia di famiglia che di contatti politici con le grosse famiglie di Bentivoglio, eccetera, anche cardinali, papi, importantissimi, per cui lavorò accanto ai più grandi compositori del primo 600, dei primi 20 anni, 600 a Roma. So the music we hear is basically halved in two parts. The first, after a brief introduction by Francesco da Milano, there will be pieces, little pieces by Holborn and Dowland. So Anthony Holborn, a very well known, locally well known, actually more internationally well known, composer for group concert music for the families who wanted to perform home music, music at home, at the end of the 16th and early 17th century. He died very young. The career of John Dowland, vice versa, was European wide. In France, in Denmark, in Italy. He was in Italy for important years working for the family to protect his, his trouble. And then back to the north, he had some trouble because he had converted to Catholicism in France. And it was not as easy as he thought to get back a position at court. He only got a position in 1612, which is very late for his career. Alla fine del concerto sentiremo invece musica di appunto questo compositore che devo nominare adesso, Kapsberg, un tedesco di padre tedesco austriaco militare, però nato in Italia, trasferito a Roma e molto così ambizioso, tanto da quasi voler succedere a Palestrina, di essere lui il compositore, il simbolo della Chiesa ufficiale di Roma. Di Kapsberg sentirete della musica virtuosissima, sono le toccate, musica modernissima. Si dice sempre che la combinazione del fasto barocco e dell'economia della controriforma, musica molto severa ma all'occorrenza ai fuochi artificiali che sentirete. So Kapsberg at the end of the concert will show display, especially toccatas, music in which the very severe Roman Baroque style is combined with extremely virtuoso run work, so virtuoso exhibition of fast, extreme rhetorical gestures. Voglio finire con un aneddoto, che è questo. Kapsberg aveva un'accademia a casa, insegnava ai giovani talenti delle famiglie importanti. E il fratello di Galileo Galilei, da Monaco, inviò suo figlio Vincenzo, dunque il nipote di Vincenzo, figlio di questo fratello di Galileo. Era la speranza della famiglia a suonare il liuto, però era estremamente piccolo, quanto sappiamo, e non ebbe molto successo, anzi non ebbe alcun successo, nessun progresso. La cosa finì malissimo, ci sono molte lettere di Galileo su questo evento, inclusa una lettera che a quanto pare era difesa della scuola di Kapsberg, una lettera molto bella, attribuita a Galileo da Favaro, poi con gli anni anche da Panofsky, eccetera, e recentemente invece sentita, come non di Galileo, ma sì di ambiente, e che infatti pare sia stata indirizzata al gruppo di Kapsberg. So the story is that Kapsberg had a school at home, an academy, was a teacher of importance, young members of important families, including a nephew of Galileo Galilei, who was not very successful because extremely lazy. So it's an interesting note of color to finish. Kapsberg was the famous teacher to which Galileo addressed a very important letter in which he confronted different arts, including, this is the point, vocal music, theater, and lute playing. The lute playing would for him be the best. In italiano, la lettera finisce con il confronto tra teatro, musica vocale e musica strumentale per liuto. E Galileo Galilei, contro tutto il trend dell'epoca, che tutti amavano l'opera, lui preferiva la musica per liuto, perché è economica e dimostra il virtuosismo del tempo. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. John Dowland, in the moment when he felt abandoned by Queen Elizabeth, he left for the continent. He spent some time in Italy, and he spent 6 years in Denmark at the court of Christian IV, and he spent 1 year in Germany, 6 months at the court of Moritz von Hessen, and 6 months at the court of Heinrich Julius von Braunschweig. And at the court of Heinrich Julius, one of his colleagues was the Flemish lutenist Gregory Hewitt. And 15 years later, this is 1594-95, 15 years later, 1610, Dowland published this fantasy by the most famous Gregorio Hewitt. Chromaticism was all the rage at this time, and the theme is half chromatic here, and it gives a poignancy and depth to the fantasy that one would wish you could, one could also find in the other works by Gregory Hewitt. If, however, you look at the other pieces by Hewitt which have survived, they don't come close in quality to the fantasy published by Dowland. And my theory is that he had a helping hand in making the version that he published. So I will play now the only prelude that we have by Dowland, which is quite short and doubly eloquent as an introduction to this quite fascinating fantasy by Gregory Hewitt. Finish the program, three more pieces by Kapsteiger, and the last piece, instead of the toccata number one, I will play one of the correnti. This is correnti number 7. Thank you.